Good morning. I greet you this morning in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and welcome you to worship here at the St. Thomas Reformed Church. Wherever you are today, wherever you are worshiping from, you're in God's house, God's sanctuary, and today we gather as the body of Christ to worship. I'd like to welcome all of you who are worshiping with us today, wherever you are, and a special welcome to Ruth, who's in Woodbridge, Virginia, to the Robinsons in Reston, Virginia, to David and Jane and the Kraus family in Indiana, to the Fisher family in New Jersey, to Ann in Wisconsin, and to Lisa and Jaji in Ocala, Florida, and a large group of people also worshiping from that part of Florida. Welcome to each and every one of you and to all of you. A happy Mother's Day. Today, if you cannot be with your mom physically present, make sure you give her a call today if you are able. I'd like to thank the children's choir for participating in today's worship, and also Laura Strickland for adding her gift of music today. We're so very blessed. And make sure you stick around all the way to the very end of the service today for a very special Mother's Day greeting from our children. You perhaps received, if you didn't, you will receive a letter updating you on our COVID-19 response of late. Consistory did meet and chose wisely to act on the side of caution. We'll continue live streaming our services for the immediate future. And despite the governor's safer at home orders, there is no good way and safe way to allow less than 50 people here in the sanctuary. So let's continue to pray, and please be patient as we wait for the day where we can once again come together in the sanctuary to worship. If you are watching and you would like to be listed in our online directory, please drop an email to our elder, Beth Benta. Here's her email. You can stay in touch with each other through this wonderful directory. Drop her an email and she will get you connected. With that, let us worship God as the body of Christ. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Amen. Let us pray. Creator God, architect of the universe, we praise you for this day and we give you thanks for the gift of life. You have called us to be your home. Your covenant is written on our hearts. You live in us, Lord. You have built us up to support one another as a church, to lean on one another in difficult times, and to hold one another close and to stay strong together. And so let us in our worship help to strengthen each other, to support one another, and may we live into our created intention, Lord, more deeply because of your love for us. Bless those who gather today to worship, Lord, wherever they are. Bless them and now bind us together with your love in our worship. In the holy name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And so let us now approach the throne of grace, seeking forgiveness for our sin, as we pray this unison prayer of confession together. O God, living water, bright light, gentle dove, our true and lasting hope, in the water of baptism you claimed us as your very own, and ever since you have been preparing us for eternity with you. Your loving grip upon us is strong and sure. Yet we confess that we defy and disregard who you created us to be and who we truly are through Christ Jesus. Sometimes ignorantly, sometimes willfully, even sometimes spitefully, we live in ways that do not suit your children. Nevertheless, your holy stamp upon us is indelible. Your claim upon us is eternal. Wash us in your abundant grace and soak us with your Holy Spirit, so that more and more we become who we already are, your beloved children, sisters and brothers of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And we can never lose the way. We can always turn back and find forgiveness, healing, restoration, because Jesus laid down his life for us. May we each know the truth of God's love and love one another. Believe the good news that in Christ our sins are forgiven and now live in peace. Amen.
I have decided to follow Jesus. Always, I'll follow Jesus. For now and always.
And so once again, to all you mothers, happy Mother's Day to you, and receive our love from this your church family today. If you had been coming up the steps on a normal Sunday, we'd be greeting you with a flower and wishing you a happy Mother's Day. And so we do that today virtually to all of you. And think about that while you're in exile. I hate to use that word, but it feels like that's what it is in some ways. We're exiled from this, our church home. And that's what exile is, away from home. You're away from what is familiar, what is safe. You're left with a deep longing to be somewhere else, somewhere where you are not. And I don't know if it's even helpful to recall what we may have been doing under normal circumstances, because it's hard to know what normal circumstances are anymore. It's all new, but that's what makes this passage from 1 Peter surprisingly timely and relevant for today. Peter is writing to a people in exile. In fact, he begins the letter like this: Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who have been chosen and destined by God the Father, and sanctified by the Spirit to be obedient to Jesus Christ and to be sprinkled with his blood. May grace and peace be yours in abundance. And what does Peter say to these chosen, destined, sanctified people? Today's reading starts chapter 2, verse 2. I'm not exactly sure why the lectionary leads out verse 1, rid yourselves therefore of all malice and guile, insincerity, envy, and all slander. I guess they didn't want to mess up a perfect Mother's Day. That's just not good fodder for a Mother's Day sermon. So just get rid of the malice and the envy and the slander. Just get rid of, rid yourselves of that, and then we're done with verse 1. Chapter 2, verse 2. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, see, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Add the blessing of your Holy Spirit now to your word, O God, that it may reach our hearts and leave us changed from glory into glory. Amen. I wonder how that sounded to you. Accurate? You are a chosen race. Oh. Me? Chosen? You are a royal priesthood. Yeah, okay, royalty. I like the sound of that. You are a holy nation. Holy? What exactly do you mean by holy? Holy. Do you think of yourself as holy? If you do, you're probably not. But holiness gets a bad rap, I think. Too many times it's associated with, oh, you think you're better than me. Holier than thou. And it's become almost cliche. Oh, it's something because you pray more, you're more holy. Or you go to church more, you're more holy. Or you read your Bible more, so you're more holy. But let's be clear, holiness is not so much what we do, it is who we are. You are a holy nation. Holy literally means set apart. You are a holy nation. You are set apart. And that's not something you did. It's something God did with you and for you. It's not what we do, it's who we are. Holy. Set apart. This is part of the conversation that I've been having with my small but committed confirmation class. Three students, Grace, Natalia, and Tyler. They've all been meeting with me virtually and their mentors every week to discuss what it means to be a Christian. What it means to say, I believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son. And how to answer the very basic question of faith. What is my only comfort in life and in death? That I am not my own, but I belong. I belong. I belong because I have been chosen. Set apart. I am God's very own child. This is who I am. And if this is who you are, then who it is you are called to be, then be who you are called to be. That's what being holy means. It means following Jesus and letting the Word of God inform your everyday living. So that you become sanctification for my confirmation class, more and more like the person God created you to be. Holy. And no, this doesn't just happen. The knowledge of Christ, the gift of faith, it is passed down through generations. Like newborn infants, Peter says, long for the pure spiritual milk so that by it, you may grow into salvation. You see, we were all once babes in Christ. Whether we were born into a believing family and raised in it, or whether we discovered this faith later in life, there was a beginning. And Peter's point is, no matter where you are on that journey, is to long for that spiritual nourishment, like pure spiritual milk. Like a newborn infant instinctively grasps for a mother's milk, because it is essential for growth, and without it, you die. You get it? I can think of no better illustration of this than the three who are taking this confirmation class. Grace. Nurtured by her mother, Andrea. Natalia, nurtured by her mother, Chantel. And Tyler, nurtured by his mother, Nisha. And I have to say it, Pastor Jeff, nurtured by his mother, Barbara. Ha! You see? It's beautiful. Today we give thanks for mothers who have passed down the gift of faith. Mothers who have fed and nourished us as we grow into salvation, to become who we are in Christ. And this is how it is supposed to work. But it's not just moms who do this. The church, the household of God, is where those who are nourished in Christ will grow into salvation. Here is where the metaphor of being built, in the Greek it's oikodomaste, a spiritual house. We are being built into a spiritual house. This is where it reaches its full expression. And Peter, as he's writing this, may be recalling the recent memory of the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, where stones still today lie scattered about and broken. When will we ever return to our spiritual home? I think of our magnificent St. Thomas Reformed Church, this stone building, this picture that you see every Sunday now if you're watching online, the photo that Don Hebert took, and that is a Don Hebert photo, and it's beautiful. Thank you, Don, for that photo. This gorgeous structure that we worship in and that we are now exiled from, our church home. These stones are still very much in place, but we, like those first century Christians, are exiled, safer at home. When will we return? Listen to this. Although the traditional dwelling place of God is gone, a new house has in fact arisen in its place, and there is a royal priesthood in attendance. And yes, that is you, dear people of God, a royal priesthood, living stones founded on the cornerstone who is Christ. You are a holy nation, set apart. And you are the light that overcomes the darkness. Yes, everything is changing. But this is who we are, and it will not change. We are a holy nation set apart. And now literally set apart, but let me remind you that the present circumstance, our exile, this pandemic, our safer at home, it does not change who we are. We are God's people. We are the St. Thomas Reformed Church. And once you are chosen and set apart and consecrated and saved, and you are forever changed. Changed forever. And so today I want to thank God for choosing us and for saving us. I want to thank Jesus for overcoming the darkness and giving us hope. I want to thank moms who have nurtured us. And I want to thank you, church, for helping us all grow into salvation. A chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Amen. And now we respond to the hearing of God's word with the giving of our gifts, our tithes and our offerings. Let the Spirit of Christ lift you up during this time.
Thank you.
As some of you were aware, Governor Bryan issued a proclamation designating this past Thursday, May 7, as a National Day of Prayer, with a theme of Pray God's Glory, which is based on Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 14. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. He said, leaders and all citizens of our nation are afforded the privilege of prayer, affirming our spiritual heritage and the principles upon which our nation was founded. Recognizing the love and power of God, we unite with fellow citizens to exercise freedom, the freedom we have to gather with prayer and thanksgiving, with thankfulness, while seeking guidance, provision, protection, and purpose for the benefit of every individual and our state as a whole. So we exercise that privilege once again today. We pray, of course, for our mothers, for those whom this is a very special day, and for those for whom this is a difficult day. Love and loss, always a part of life. We pray for strength for moms who are now adding homeschooling to their list of things to do every day, and for our children. Lift up, if you would, those who came through our prayer chain this week, those who are battling cancer. Pray for Michael and Linda, for Pat, and for Kathy. Pray for John Black, who's recovering from surgery here in St. Thomas, and for Lucy, hospitalized in the States. Pray for Russ Silver, who left St. Thomas, who will undergo heart valve surgery after a two-week quarantine. And pray for the Gralick family and the death of Deborah's uncle, Jim. And of course, pray continued prayers for all those affected by this coronavirus, and particularly those who are fighting and helping on the front lines. Let us pray. We praise you and we thank you, O Lord, that you have fed us today with your word. Grateful for your gifts and mindful of the communion of your saints, we offer to you our prayers for all people. Today we commend mothering for the ways that it reflects the Imago Dei, the image of God, your image, Lord, by bringing forth new life, by nurturing those on the path, and living with the tension of providing both freedom and a safety net. God bless our mothers. God of compassion, we remember before you the poor and the afflicted, the sick and the dying. prisoners and all those who are lonely, victims of war and injustice and inhumanity, and all who suffer from whatever their sufferings may be called. Be with those who I mentioned this morning and those who we now lift in the quiet of our hearts. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Keep us, good Lord, under the shadow of your mercy in this time of uncertainty and distress. Sustain and support the anxious and the fearful, and lift up all who are brought low, that we may rejoice in the comfort, knowing that nothing can separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Author of grace and God of love, send your Holy Spirit's blessing now to all present. Keep our hearts and thoughts in Jesus Christ, your only Son, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. holy, set apart as the beloved people of God. And until we who are apart can be together again, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen. Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. I love you so much. Thank you for literally everything. You mean the world to me. I love you.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Thank you for always being there for me. I love you so much.
Happy Mother's Day, Mama. I love you. Thank you for all the food that you make me. And thank you for always being there for me and being just somebody that I can lean on. Do the best.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. And thank you for all that you've done for me throughout the years of being a great support and somebody to look up to. And I just thank you for the gift of faith that you've given to me and passed down for generations.
Hi, good afternoon. My name's Isabella. I love my mommy because she did everything for me. And I love God because He created the universe.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom.
Happy Mother's Day, Mommy. I love you because you take good care of me.
One thing I love about God is that He always takes care of me. And one thing I love, and some things I love about my mom, is that she feeds me and she helps me stay healthy.
I love Jesus forever and ever and ever, and I love Mommy forever and ever and ever.
My mom is amazing. Happy Mother's Day, Mom. I love you very, very much.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.